Hey everybody, welcome to Mapped Out Radio, and today we're going to be doing an in-depth interview with Amber Long, internationally acclaimed electronic music producer and vocalist, who resides right here in our part of the world. Her full-time home is Toronto, but lately she's been spending a lot of time here in Ottawa, and that's how we at Music Art People have been able to get to know her. She has a trademark sound that is uniquely her own. Sought after globally and supported by big name artists, her lyrics, voice, and productions are well known amongst the underground music community. Passionate and animated, Amber is the living demonstration of an artist who loves her work intensely and continually tears up dance floors across the world. Aside from DJing globally, Amber Long runs the Toronto-based independent labels Modern Agenda and Modern Architect, a brand that focuses on giving back to its large roster of artists. We had the chance to catch up with Amber and chat about her journey, her music, the collaboration she is most proud of, her internationally known label, and what inspires her as she continues to create through this worldwide pandemic. Welcome, Amber Long.
Hey there, Nick. Thank you so much for having me, guys.
No worries. Thanks for being here. So before we get into the label, the mixes, the collabs, the industry, and most importantly, some of your newest tracks, I want to know, how did you start your journey? When did you get started in electronic music? And when did you start collaborating with some of the biggest producers on the planet?
I think that would have been probably like 2010, 2011. Sasha actually had a remix competition that went out into the world. And at that time, Robert Mason was actually doing a remix, just part of this remix competition. And I got it in my head. I was like, oh, I want remixes of my tunes, because I'd been making electronic tunes, but they were more like indie dance sort of thing. So I was like, I want remixes for my tunes. And that's kind of how I got on Beatport, is that some of my original stuff that was more indie dance started getting remixes. And then it just kicked off from there, because somehow, I was giving out my vocals for different things, and then people started to see the name, and it kind of just grew organically from there. But yeah, that's how it started.
Nice. Yeah, you know, it's all got to start somewhere. So I know spoken word is important to you, and really kind of how you started out too as well. So tell me a little bit about that, your time in that art form. What did you learn in that world that you were able to bring to electronic music?
Well, I actually think that the spoken word part is actually one of my foundations, and something, a way that I use even now to create, because it sounds maybe, I don't know how it sounds, and it doesn't matter. I am a poet. I love writing poetry. I think in rhymes. I think in lyrics and words with a cadence, just in everyday thoughts. That's just how my brain works. And the spoken word is pretty much like everything, even the lyrics and the vocals and the singing stuff that I do today, it always starts with a poem, or it always starts with a rhythm, which has always been from the beginning. So spoken word, I still do it even to this day for some tracks. You know, if you hear some of my spoken stuff, and it's not that I ever come back to it, and it's not that I've ever left. It's one of my foundations.
Nice. And, so cool how you're able to parlay that into, a career in the electronic music industry. You know, it shows you how, if you pivot and you really take advantage of your different skill sets, it's you can do anything. So, I'm wondering, what are some of the things you learned as you worked more and more in the music field? What advice might you give to aspiring producers and vocalists who are just coming up today?
I think my advice probably would have changed over the years. And now that we're on the other side of 2020, I really feel strongly that there's no better time to embrace what you have to offer creatively, because there's a huge audience out there for whatever you want to make. And there's somebody looking for whatever you want to make. And if you pour your heart and soul into it, there's always going to be an audience. And I don't think I kind of got caught up a little bit more in the business, because it was so, it everything felt so much bigger before 2020, but when you break it all down, I think the most important thing is to constantly like put your heart and soul into whatever you're making and not think, you know, or not like put any specific results or hopes or wishes on it, and just do it with heart.
Yeah, so true. You know, I think as artists and musicians and producers get so caught up in the business that we sometimes forget about the audience out there listening, right? And the type of moments that people are having. I know, you know, when sometimes somebody will grab me and say, oh, this mix that you did, I was listening to it on my bike or going for a jog or doing something like that. And, you know, it's awesome. It's an awesome moment because it's like, oh, you know, that's what I experience with other people's music as well. So it's a great experience to create like that and to kind of put yourselves in the shoes of the people who are receiving that creation as well. So awesome. So you've done some vocals for some legendary producers. You've done some amazing collabs and features. So I really want to know, I'm going to put you on the hot seat a little bit here. What have been some of your favorite collaborations so far?
There's so many. And if you want to talk experiences, my favorite ones are the ones that always have a story behind them. So if there's a reason or if there's a story behind them, so maybe the one called Sophia, you know, Sophia, it was in remembrance of somebody, a young lady, a young artist in Argentina who was lost, and we kind of made a memorial kind of tune for that. So that one has, you know, I'm even getting choked up talking about it. That one is very special. And on the flip side, there's other ones that have really fun experiences attached to them, kind of like the Red Light Stories one that I did with Lanya and DJ Zombie and Dinox. Like, that one is more of a fun story, and the back and forth and the experience of creating that one, we didn't know where it was going to land, but we, you know, we had fun with the experience. So I don't want to like name drop any specific names, even though I said those last two. I just want to generalize it, and the things that have meaning are the ones that stand out in my head. It doesn't matter what they do in the charts or where they go, the ones with heart. So I will say right now, I'm working on one that I sang the vocals for a lady who passed away in, you know, the plane crash in Iran. So
right, yeah.
It was somebody's mom through somebody, and I'm working with Robert and the producer to put that one together. So things like that, they have a lot of heart, and the experience and the emotion, it really allows me to tap into what I was just talking about, the heart and soul versus doing something functional.
Yeah. And, you know, art is really healing, right? And, you know, to be able to put that into the world and sort of heal not only ourselves, but to help other people heal as well. So, you know, that's huge. I think what I'm getting from you is that every track is a bit of its own journey, and you really just have to enjoy that journey rather than sort of staring at the finish line going, okay, I want this track on Beatport, or, you know, I can't wait till I see the wave on SoundCloud. It's more about, you know, the back and forth and the journey. So that's great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
So speaking of collabs, I know that today, actually, you have a new track debuting all across the internet. So that's exciting. And it was made with the fellow Canadian producer Waxman. So tell me a little bit more about this track, and why is it important for you to produce with the fellow local musicians?
Ooh, two-part question. Waxman and I have been working together. I met him because he works at Lynx Music in Toronto. And when I was so fortunate to discover that, and it became kind of my studio base and recording space in Toronto, we developed a friendship and had a lot of people that we knew in common. And it's kind of like what we do is kind of like the band thing where we get together in the room and we co-create. And I do that with Robert Mason, you know? So those would be the two people that would be kind of local that I would sit and co-create with. And Casual Conversations is an example of one of these where we walked in, we wrote the lyrics and recorded them the same day, and then, you know, arranged them later on. But kind of the back and forth was very, very organic. And it's something I don't often get a chance to do that because of the international collaborations. So coming from the indie side of things, I really appreciate being able to actually go into a physical studio, do things face to face, you know, get out paper and pen and actually do things kind of the old school way, where it's like a brainstorming and you see what happens, you know. Luckily with Robert, I had that in our house, but in this situation with Waxman, we worked at Lynx Music. And yeah, Casual Conversations, I would love to say that it has super profound meaning, but the whole thing was we set out to make something fun, a pretty vocal track, you know, and just, it was a poetry session that turned into that.
That's awesome. You know, one thing about electronic music and DJing is sometimes it's very solitary. So, you know, to be able to plug into a collaboration and a partnership like that, I think it's very powerful. And, you know, it's very fulfilling as well. So, you know, good on you for being able to have that. And also, you know, being able to hook up with local producers and musicians. So, you know, right now, let's take a listen to this freshly released Casual Conversations. I know there's a bunch of great mixes. So I invite everybody to check that out now that it's been released, but why don't we take a listen to the original mix. So we'll be right back with Amber Long after the premiere of Casual Conversations with Waxman. Okay, let's shift gears here and talk about mixes for a bit, something near and dear to my heart. And you really seem to be pumping them out. You have guest mixes all over the place. It literally, I was just scrolling for days and days. Your SoundCloud is stacked. How in the world do you keep it up? I mean, do you make time every day or every week? Do you kind of have a certain day? Is it kind of Fridays or maybe Monday mornings? You know, and then, you know, what are some of your favorite guest mixes that you maybe want to mention as well?
I think you're so funny. You're right. I do a lot of guest mixes and they have amped up a lot. Okay. As an artist, there's certain things that give you a dopamine rush, right? Okay. So a track or releasing a track, that's a long term. It takes a long term time to get that dopamine rush of actually getting from point A to Z. And part of it is in the creation of that. But with a mix, that excitement and that feeling from putting together other people's tracks, and like it's a dopamine rush and gets me very excited in my own space at home. I get excited about the promos that are coming out. I get excited about how they work together. I find new artists on a regular basis. Like I literally take a photo of what the tune is and I go and I contact that artist and ask them to make an EP for Modern Agenda. Especially now with lockdown, there are so many artists who have music that needs to be respected and played, and there's not a large audience out there in person. And there's so much music coming out that if I have platforms that want to take that music and those promos and that artist or that producer, you know, even 10 people hear it or 20 people hear it because I put it in a mix, I really want to respect the work that they're doing throughout the pandemic. And that requires me, I feel, with the radio show and like any requests, I feel like that puts a responsibility on me to get the stuff out there. And if I really love it, I get it out there more often so that it hits more audiences. And I guess if I can't be doing this live, or if I can't make the connections live, I'm still trying to support the artists in any way I can in possibly an excessive guest mix format. But if I was playing, I would be playing 4 or 5 times in, you know, a couple weeks somewhere. And I would have a lot of time to play out the tracks that I thought were amazing. And I might not even be able to keep up with the promos, but this way I have the time and I, you know, it's just a little thing that I can do to say, hey, artist, I love your work. Please don't get discouraged. Like, it's amazing, and give it a play, you know?
Oh, yeah, totally. And I just counted 60 guest mixes on your SoundCloud. So people have a lot of music that could potentially be over 60, 70 hours worth of music, people. So definitely go on there. Want to throw a little spotlight on the mix you did for us, the Music Art People Presents mix. That was our last mix that we released of 2020. It was amazing mix. Another one that I listened to earlier this week was the Great Cast mix that really stuck out to me. Really enjoyed that one. Any particular mixes that you kind of go and listen to again and again that you love there, or you kind of, they're all like children, you love them all equally?
No, because it's all a different headspace, right? Same thing as if you go into the studio, you come at things with different purpose and like feelings, right? So for your mix, for the Music RP, it's really actually one of my favorite mixes, and I have it in my link tree as a little button on its own as a mix to go check out on my Instagram. Because I thought about what you guys represent. And again, I want to feel connected to why I'm doing something. So I thought about what you guys represent and the different sounds that come out of your brand, you know, and I went at it like choosing tracks for that and specifically for you out of, you know, my love for what you guys are doing. And I did one in the summer for Deeper Dimensions, out of Toronto. And that one was kind of like the same one where they were a little bit, it was, you know, about really get in touch with the musical side of things. And if you know you have an audience that's going to super, super love and respect the musicality of things, I put in a lot of effort to find tracks that have that musicality because I know it's going to an appreciative audience. Whereas some people expect, you know, they ask for a progressive house set or they ask for a melodic techno set, and that kind of puts walls up. Whereas when I'm doing things for collectives such as yourself or Deeper Dimensions, that's asking for more of my creative side as a DJ.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that Deeper Dimensions one. I really like that one too. A little bit deeper, a little bit different sound than I know you for, but I really enjoyed that one the other day. Popped that one on for a cross-country ski and went pretty deep. So really enjoyed that. So speaking of mixes, let's talk a little bit about live streams, something I know you're big into as well. It seems that's really all we have since the pandemic. So how have you found performing virtually, and what have been some of your favorite streams that you've DJed? Also, any advice to those DJs at home that are thinking of dipping their toes into streaming?
I forgot you asked this question because I just recorded a vlog last night all about this because I got really excited this past week about this. So in the beginning, we had just come back from Mexico, and then all of a sudden everything's online and we have to start live streaming and, you know, checking your internet connection. Is your computer strong enough? How do you do this through a cell phone? Is the audio okay? Why is this like, why do I look like a stop frame animation? Why is Facebook silencing all the, and there were so many questions that it was really overwhelming. And so after trying it a couple times, I was just like, no, I'm not doing this until I get a grip on what's going on. So from there, I had more time to research what was happening, and I waited instead of using my own channels. I waited for other channels to ask something from me. So that's how the Burning Man set came to be. And with that, there was a lot of notice. And instead of people started realizing there was a benefit to pre-recording the sets and then having them go live after, because there was far more control after trial and error and a lot of things dropping and things going wrong, rather than think of it in, you know, a negative sense that this isn't going live exactly, that at least you're getting this person's attention and performance and whatever they're doing for this particular gig. So with a little bit more time, I was able to put things together in a bit of a production, you know, which everybody started getting really bored of people just throwing on record and just doing something without much thought. So I wanted my live streams to have a little bit more thought behind them, to be more entertainment based, because that's kind of who I am and what I do. And so those ones, with more planning, they got really exciting. And I figured, you know, if social media is now the gig, you know, then there has to be levels of what you'll do for the gig. So if it's a paid gig, you're going to get a production type video where there's a lot of thought and everything put into it. You know, if it's like a guest mix video, chances are, like the last one I did the other week, I'm going to set something up in my place and I'm going to use my gear and make it look pretty and whatnot. But the production won't be behind it in the same way, because this is a way that we're learning to communicate and it's not going away. So finding the levels on how we do things and what we give to our audiences, I think, like, I'm finding a balance in that one. I don't know if that's so true.
And, you know, I think that's some great advice. We'll keep our eye for that vlog. Where can people check out that vlog if they want to go a little deeper on that subject?
Well, part of my thing is it's on my YouTube, just Amber Long YouTube. It's called the DIY Underground Podcast. And it started out as an audio podcast. But since I've been pent up at home and having a lot of time on my hands, I'm feeling like firecrackers of creative sparks going in my head. So I'm just throwing on the camera, you know, and recording them as they happen in my life while I'm stuck at the house. So I don't guarantee they're going to be going on forever. But if something inspires me, I have been throwing them up on my YouTube. And again, my link tree, I have a little button on it for the DIY Underground videos.
Nice. Yeah, well, that kind of leads into my next question, and on the subject of creativity and the pandemic and everything going on. I'm wondering, have you found it more of a challenge to create, or has it been easier with all this going on?
In the beginning, I felt that there was a lot of pressure to maintain the output that there once was, you know, even a couple of years ago. And I think that every artist out there, it took them some time to actually get used to what the new normal, or sorry for using that catchphrase, but like what things are going to be like, at least for now, at least in Canada, at least in North America, or, you know, we had to get used to it. So I think there was a bit of a grieving period where a lot of artists probably grieved all the tours they lost, or the gigs, or the festivals. Even the audience grieved there for a little bit. So during that time, I personally found it hard to be creative, hence why I was trying to like be motivational with my posts or make these videos or something. But I think now, personally, I've kind of come to grips as to the fluctuating way of the world, and I'm ready to be flexible and embrace how it's going. I'm, you know, embracing technology and how that works. I'm getting more comfortable on video. I've set myself up with a specific studio. Like, after the grieving, we started adjusting, and that's where I'm right at now. So whether the world opens up in the next 6 months or a year, I put everything together so that everything that I need is right here now.
Yeah, that's great. And I think, you know, that's sort of what everybody's sort of focusing on, is sort of growing their skills and seeing where they can kind of do stuff maybe that they didn't have time to before. So that's fantastic, Amber. But honestly, you must miss traveling, though. Will you be pumped to hit the road again once this is all gone? And if so, where are you most excited to go once all this clears up?
I am super excited, and literally you're going to catch me probably first person in the line, like holding up my passport. You just wait for Instagram stories to blow up when I have my passport in hand. No, I'm just joking. Yes, I'm looking forward to moving around the world again when it's safe for everyone involved. And I not only work corporately, but also creatively in live events. So for me, I take everything really seriously, and the safety of everything I love relies on what I do as, you know, somebody in this world. So I'm taking this time right now to grow creatively. And as soon as it's safe, I'm jumping on a plane, and you'll probably find me in India, because my partner, I would say one of my partners with Modern Agenda, her name is Priya Sen. She does the A&R, and I miss all my friends that I can't see that I've met, but through this pandemic and all of her help and support and our almost daily calls and like messages and just the support, I have to go see her. You know, this isn't even about going to tour or going to have a gig. This is about the pandemic teaching me about the importance of people, you know? And so, yeah, that I want to be on a plane to India so that I can meet her as soon as possible.
Nice. Yeah, that's a great story. And we'll be watching your stories, your Instagram stories, to live vicariously through you for those who may not be able to get on that plane. So that's fantastic. So I want to talk a little bit about an upcoming release that you have. It's a very exciting release. It's a remix, or it's a cover of the Everything But the Girl's classic Missing. So this must have been a bit of a tricky track for you, knowing that it's the original is so well known. Tell me a little bit more about the process and recording a track that's well known like this.
This one started out as me standing at Link Studio using a beautiful mic. And normally I don't do covers for anything, but for some reason, I always use like really old dance tunes to warm up to when I'm warming up my vocals, like to sing vocals. So in this particular instance that day, I was using Missing to warm up to actually sing my own vocals to. But then I got so into it and I remembered how much I loved it that I worked really hard to do it right. And there's no possible way in come hell or high water, there's no possible way that I could do that tune justice in the same way as the original. Like the singer, I'm not even sure of her name, but she just does such a great job, right? So I guess part of that was like a practice session to try and test out different intonations. And it went out as just a free download. I sent out the vocals as like, hey, if you want to play with this. And I stuck it on my SoundCloud and I didn't think much of it. And there was actually a few different ones that came back. So Audio Glider made one, and then there was another one that came out from Zev, who's an American producer. But then this one, the Juan Pablo Torres, I didn't even know that he had the vocals. I didn't know anything. And one day I just got a link through WhatsApp and I pressed play. And I got to say, this one in particular actually hits so much like the original that I got goosebumps and I like, you know, it was one of those like emotional moments where I was like, oh my God, this takes me back to 1995. This is so everything to me right now. And you know, there were some parts where I cursed the fact that it was just kind of like warm up vocals and trying to just put something out for free and, you know, like just be creative in that sense. I had no idea that it would come out to being something like this. So I'm so grateful for this one because it's going out as a free download, but for what it did for my soul. And I think for anybody else who loved that tune, there's little parts, what he did with the vocal that are so reminiscent that it's going to hit.
Yeah, no, that's a great story. You know, talk about, you know, one of those clandestine collaborations. So, you know, good for you. So I'm sure people at home and listening now will be curious to take a listen to the track. So without further ado, I think this might be a bit of a worldwide debut here on Mapped Out Radio. Let's take a listen to the famous track Missing, and we'll be right back with Amber Long after this. Okay, we're back with Amber Long. So if being a DJ, electronic music producer, singer, and mom weren't enough, you also run a music label, Modern Agenda. So tell us a little bit more about the label. When did you start that and how is it going?
I love Modern Agenda very much. Modern Agenda was born probably 5.5 years ago. And it's not just me. It's not just me who does everything for Modern Agenda. It was a concept put together by Robert Mason and myself. And then from there, we included, you know, friends and people that we love and trust. And it kind of started as a very grassroots operation where each of us had our roles. And I guess the reason why people think that it's like my label is I do, it's come to the point where I do pick out the tunes and I do make the okays for everything, you know, and it's gotten to that point, but everybody has their own unique position. You know, somebody is out there doing promotion. Somebody is out there doing the A&R. Sometimes we wear different hats. You know, we have a couple, I don't know if you saw the new rebranding, but there were two different graphic design artists who put those together for us, one for Modern Agenda and one for Modern Architect that I just put out today. And we're working with the same kind of people that have the same heart and soul that we put into it, you know? So I do run Modern Agenda, but it's definitely a team-oriented situation. And I absolutely love it because we work with people from all over the world. And now we're going a little bit more into a tailored sound because we've been doing this for 5 years, right? Everybody needs a bit of a refresh or things get lost, you know? I wanted to freshen things up. I wanted things to be fresh for 2021 because 2020 drained us. It drained the music industry. I wanted to freshen everything up. And with that comes a new way of doing things. So now we're going to be focusing on putting out EPs of original work specifically so that the artists get the respect that they deserve for their original work. And same thing with Architect. It's going to be primarily originals just to showcase artists' original work. And then the very few remixes that we do have coming, we want them to be very special. But there aren't going to be that many. So it's very artist focused at this point, edgier sound, you know, far more progressive techno, very danceable, but we want it to be very edgy and moody and dark.
Nice. You know, great to hear. And definitely hear you on the teamwork. I know at Music Art People, that's a huge part of what we do. We couldn't do it without all that support and collaboration. So I'm wondering, where do you see the label maybe in another 5 years? What kind of projects would you like to be working on then?
I believe it's going to evolve organically at this point with shifting the focus primarily on the artists. And that really alleviates a lot of work on this side because now I'm out there not only being a DJ, I'm out there being a scout, you know, and that allows us to build things and create more of a brand and be very brand specific as far as sound so that you know every time you press on one of our covers, it's not going to sound the same, but it's going to have the same artistic approach where it's an art piece. It's somebody's EP. It's not, you know, it's something that they put their energy and time into and custom made specifically for Modern Agenda. And that in a world that's gone super digital, I want to add the human back into that as far as Modern Agenda and respecting the artists and their work.
Right on. You know, that's a great goal, and it's nice to hear you've got that vision and definitely hear you about the organic growth. You know, I know at Music Art People, we've been, you know, just like, wow, you know, how something can grow organically. And, you know, it definitely takes work and effort, but sometimes it becomes a life of its own. So totally hear you about that. So I know you've spoken a bit about being a woman in a male dominated industry like electronic music production. I know we here at MAP pride ourselves in gender diversity with our bookings, and we're starting to see more female DJs and producers moving to the top in recent years. I'm wondering if you have seen a bit of a shift change since you started in the industry.
Normally something like this I wouldn't comment on, but I think at this point in time and it being 2021 is something I actually do have to have a comment about by saying I do think it's changing. I think it's really inspiring to see everybody working together. I think it's inspiring that women are feeling, you know, feeling powerful enough to put out their electronic music creations, whatever they may be. I do think it's changing, and I really, we're far more powerful if we work together. That's another reason why I respect you guys, because you are very much like that. You are totally respectful of women, men. You're sensitive in how you put things out there. You're respectful, and I love that. I love that. And I think that more and more of our industry is actually demanding that from our audience and that understanding. And the more that we're shown this kind of normalcy, and the more that we're shown this like symbiotic relationship that we can all have, I think the more it will become the norm.
Yeah, so true. And I know you've really blazed a trail for, you know, female producers and DJs, vocalists and spoken words. So, you know, really tap on your back and, you know, really well done for that. So as we look ahead, you know, can we expect any juicy new collaborations coming? What do you have coming down the pipe?
Yes. Well, there is this one that I was telling you about. I might as well just tell you it's Naveed Mayer and Robert Mason and myself for that emotional one. And then I have, I don't know if you remember Uvation. I did a track with him. He's a French producer and he took a little bit of time away. So as far as vocal stuff is concerned, we had done one a few years ago called Son, which meant sun. And this year, this is another one where you can catch the spoken word, because we did one called Father. So this is another special one. I'm not sure where it's landing, but it was another special one where it was in dedication to my dad and his dad as well. So it's got some specialness to it. I guess 2020, I only opened my mouth to do vocals and sing for things that emotionally moved me, because the rest of the world took so much emotion out of me and the things that were happening. So those are really special. I have some production collaborations that are coming, one with Pedro Capolassi, one with Echo Babylon, and, you know, just testing the new waters of what this year and this new freedom is doing for me. So yeah, there's stuff in the pipes.
That's awesome. Yeah, we'll definitely keep an eye on your Beatport, your SoundCloud, and your Linktree to see all those coming out. And what about guest mixes? Are you going to take a little bit of a break? Or are you churning some more guest mixes out? Anything we should keep an eye for there?
Surprise, surprise. I haven't said yes to one in ages because I've been focusing on the other things. So I do have my monthly radio show, Rogue. So I will be putting together something this weekend for that. But because I have a few more video mixes and productions and, you know, releases coming, I'm putting my energy towards those. So when I have more time to be the DJ, you know, it goes in cycles, whatever feeds your soul. So when I have more time and energy, I will go back and do some guest mixes. But for now, I'm focusing more on productions, you know, the label, Modern Agenda, Modern Architect, and that sort of stuff.
That's perfect. You know, until this radio show airs and then people hear that you have time and they'll start hitting you up for guest mixes, you're good until then, right?
So, I don't have time.
So what's the best place that people can follow and support you? What are some of those channels that you really want to push out?
I would really love it if people would hit a like on the Spotify side of things, because I don't really know much about Spotify and I'm not good at marketing or doing anything on there. So I know that if there's followers and people like the tunes and put them in their playlists on there, it actually helps the algorithm. It seems all the other channels like that are, usual, you know, you can find my stuff. It's just Spotify is still a mystery to me. So that would be greatly appreciated. And I'm trying to build the YouTube, my YouTube stuff. So I put the video mixes or, you know, stuff like that up there. Or you could just message me. Right, you could just say, hey, what do you got?
Yeah, there you go. That's a direct way to do it. But for sure, hopefully people surf over, and we'll add those links onto the description for this episode for everybody as well. So thanks so much, Amber. I know you were originally supposed to play our Echoes Volume 2 show, but obviously that got canceled last year. But I trust that we will be able to perform live and together soon, and you'll have your Ottawa show. So I'm wondering if there are any last words you want to leave our audience with.
I just want to thank you very much for having me as a guest and congratulate you on your new show. This is really exciting, and it's been a long time since I've been able to be on actual community radio, which I love and support very much. So thank you. And as far as the artists out there, whether you feel creative or whether you don't, you just got to roll with how you're feeling right now, because creativity always comes back. You know, you always have to trust that creativity comes back. So you got to be kind to yourself, do what you're feeling. And, you know, just because you're not creative today, it doesn't mean you won't be tomorrow.